I'm Jean Innes. I'm the CEO of the Alan Turing Institute, and I'm delighted that you can join us, both in person and online, for this gathering of pioneering AI and data science. We are experiencing an extraordinary pace of innovation, with recent breakthroughs in reasoning on device, diffusion models opening up faster and lower cost large language models, and robots learning sophisticated tasks at dramatically increased speeds. But let's take a step back. We are living in a new age, the age of algorithms, and anybody coming to AI UK understands that they are all around us. And history teaches us that when a technological revolution shakes the economy and generates huge potential, opportunities and risks, a disruptive and difficult process of learning and adaption must take place over decades to realize the full potential of the new technology. We are at an early stage of this process. And the choices we make now will define our social and economic prosperity for years to come. At the AI summit in Paris about a month ago, I reflected on the position of the UK, and I see a unique combination of strengths: world-leading researchers and universities, world-leading AI startups and scale-ups and innovative large companies, Europe's leading venture capital market and a global financial centre, a track record of leading innovation in both computer hardware and software, a strong civil society tradition and organisations, in order to use these technologies, make sure we use them in the right way, a history of thoughtful and proportionate regulation of emerging technologies, an international outlook, an enthusiasm for collaboration, a supportive government on the front foot. And our citizens are embracing these technologies. We have one of the highest rates of adoption for e-commerce globally. Realizing the UK's AI potential will require a sustained and collective effort nationally and internationally. And that's why coming together as an AI and data science community really matters, to learn and debate and to generate new ideas and new collaborations to shape our AI future. And as the National Institute for AI and Data Science, the Alan Turing Institute is playing our part. Our purpose is to achieve change for the public good through pioneering AI and data science, and by bringing together different parts of the ecosystem as we're doing today and tomorrow. Over the next 2 days, we'll hear from a wide range of experts, and we'll see ideas come to life with demonstrations and debates and workshops. And they range from developing an immune system for our critical national infrastructure, to revolutionising medical diagnosis, to protecting communities and businesses from the impact of climate change. I'd also like to thank you for coming and bringing your perspectives. I hope you come away from AI UK with at least one brilliant new idea to follow up, and at least one really exciting conversation to continue. Because together, if we get this right, putting AI to work responsibly and ambitiously, we will see the rewards over decades to come. Not just economic growth and improved public services, but transforming our economy and society to prosper in the age of algorithms. And the UK has the capability not just to contribute, but to lead the way. I would like to thank all the speakers and demonstrators taking part over these 2 days, as well as our AI UK partners who have made the event possible, and the EPSRC, the Laboratory for AI Security Research, Bridge AI, Harmony, Physics X, Prolific, and the Department for Science, Innovation and Technology. And it's now my very great pleasure to introduce the Parliamentary Undersecretary of State for AI and Digital Government, Feryal Clarke, to give our keynote address.
Good morning, everyone. I got the memo about the pink. Thank you, Jean, for the introduction, and good morning, everyone. I'm delighted to be here with you all this morning. So in 2001, I learned to code. I was studying for my master's in bioinformatics in Exeter, and that meant analysing data sets and picking up coding languages, and using that analysis to help us sequence genomes, create medicines tailored to your DNA, or predict the effects of a new drugs. This was 24 years ago, and tech looked a bit different back then. I was rocking the Nokia 6310. It was the first time the Nokias came out without the antennas. Apple had introduced the iPod, promising 10,000 songs in your pocket. And if you were anything like me, you were using it to listen to U2, or Faithless. And Steven Spielberg released AI, artificial intelligence, a futuristic fantasy about a humanoid robot trying to be a real boy. I watched a clip of her this morning. It's really sad. And in a computer lab in Devon, for this stressed out master's student, the reality of coding was an absolute nightmare. Anytime something went wrong, you'd have to scour line upon line of code trying to find your mistakes, the misplaced curly brackets in binary haystack. One error could set your research back by hours and hours, if not days. I used to have nightmares of curly brackets chasing me. And I don't need to tell you how different a picture we have before us today. When my phone is my personal assistant, my concierge, my navigator, when 90% of the world's data was created in the last 2 years, when AI is no longer the stuff of like film directors' dreams, but a practical tool changing our lives day to day, scanning for diseases in hospitals or helping teachers plan lessons, and when governments are seizing the opportunity to change how we operate too. Last month, I went to see the Government Digital Services in Whitechapel. They're using AI and other emerging tech to make interacting with state as easy as banking on the go or online shopping. And a lot of the work to do is powered by AI. And when I watched the team at work, it was amazing. They're using AI to develop like code, and then they can amend a little bit. But I saw how every time there was a tiny mistake in the code, it will flash up in colours of on the screen. Instant detection, instant fix, and it was fascinating. I haven't looked at code for many, many years. So it was incredibly, incredibly impressive. No more hours of hunting for the curly bracket or days of research lost. But globally, change is inevitable. But what's not inevitable is the UK's place in all of that. Do we stand and watch change happen, or do we take a leading role? I know that for all of us in this room, there's only one choice there. The UK's legacy is one of leadership, the third biggest market for AI in the world, driven by research from four of the world's 10 best universities, and we're home to some of the brightest luminaries in artificial intelligence, with two British Nobel Prize winners for AI just last year. That talent stands on the shoulders of Ada Lovelace, Charles Babbage, and the man whose extraordinary contribution brings us all here today. But we are not content to let the legacy remain just as that, a legacy, a history that we look back on fondly, while in present day, other countries outpace us. And British people miss out on the benefits that AI can bring to their day-to-day lives. To reap the rewards, academia industry and the public sector must work together in forums like this to solve our most pressing challenges. And the government must give you the tools to make that change possible. That's why in January, the Prime Minister launched the AI Opportunities Action Plan. It sets out how we'll unlock the economic growth that AI promises. Up to £47 billion every year for the next decade. We'll give firms and researchers access to the power and information you need to get your ideas off the ground with 20 times more computing power by 2030. Early access to the AI research resource for academics and SMEs is now live, and as we open up our supercomputers Dawn and Isambard, we'll unlock the public data sets you need to make new discoveries. And we'll also plug the skills gap by building up skills at school and nurturing research talent, both homegrown and attracted from overseas. As part of this, we're expanding the brilliant Turing AI Fellowship to give leading academics from multiple disciplines the tools they need to use AI in their work. And we'll keep supporting collaboration between academia, public sector, and industry to drive progress at the cutting edge. Now, I started by looking back to a time when text had character limits and coding mistakes caused me sleepless nights. It feels right to end by looking forward. If we get this right, if academia and public and private sector all play their roles, we do best. What could the future look like? Here's what we could say about this country. Like most new technologies before it, AI has created a raft of new and exciting jobs, adding more jobs than it replaces. Our children's children are doing jobs we don't even know the names for yet. No longer weighed down by admin, businesses are infinitely more productive. People can focus on the parts of their jobs that impact the bottom line, but also genuinely bring them joy. The strain on our health service has eased as AI saves us months on each new drug discovery, and earlier diagnosis gives patients back years with their families. And with access to the world's knowledge at ordinary people's fingertips, life in the UK becomes more equal. We know this future doesn't just happen if we press play and let time pass. It needs a supply of power and talent, careful handling on safety and ethics, and a deliberate effort to make AI work for all in this country, not just the lucky few. Progress is only possible with partnership. So, thank you to the Alan Turing Institute for bringing us together and for having me today. I hope the UK's community continues to tell the government what you need to work with us to make our AI future as storied as our past has been. This is a chapter we can only write together. Thank you.